Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the entrance of the official partner and remain standing for the playing of Ruffles and Flourishes, General's March, the presentation and posting of the colors, and the playing of the national anthem by the Air Force Band of Flight. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the invocation by Major General Baker's longtime pastor, Reverend Hal Santos.
Let's pray. Lord, we just want to give you thanks for the blessing of this occasion. We offer thanks for Major General Brent Baker and his family and years of dedication and service to our country. We pray a special blessing on him today as he enters into a new phase in his life. Use him mightily outside the military, as you have over the 37 years of serving our country in the U.S. Air Force. We also ask a blessing on his wife, Robin Lee, your family, friends, and those who have given outstanding support, and those who have contributed to his life and to his success. Give him continued desire to grow spiritually and intelligently for his own personal fulfillment, and continue to be the light in his life and the source of his confidence. In your name we pray, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Santos. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. It is my pleasure to now introduce General Wolfenbarger.
Good morning. It is absolutely my pleasure to be here today. And so I thought I'd start by adding my own personal welcome to the extended group of family and friends who have made their way here today to help be a part of this momentous occasion in the life and career of Brent and Robbie Baker. We are so pleased that you are all here today to show your support for the entire family. So many of you may have heard me preside over individual ceremonies like this, and when I was on active duty, I would always start by saying that this kind of an event was one of the most enjoyable official duties that I had as an Air Force senior leader, presiding over individual ceremonies. Well, now that I am retired, this is the only official duty that I am still allowed to perform, and therefore it is infinitely even more enjoyable now. I do consider it to be just a true honor to be asked to officiate, in particular at a retirement ceremony for one of our airmen. So I wanted to say thank you, Brent, for asking me and for giving me this opportunity to put this beloved uniform back on one more time. Well, I maintain at this retirement ceremony, we are here to do two things. We are here today to celebrate, and we are here today to honor, and I don't use that word lightly, Major General Baker for his 36 years of distinguished service to our Air Force and to our nation. So, you know, when I do these ceremonies, I do my homework. I work really hard at understanding the whole of an individual's career, where they've been and what they've done, and I always twist the arm of the individual to give me a little bit of biographical information to fill in the sketch that I have available to me in the record of performance. And, you know, it never fails to amaze me when I do a ceremony like this how much a single person can contribute over the course of an Air Force career. And that is absolutely the case here today with Brent Baker. So I'm going to share with you just a little bit of where Brent has been and what he has done. I'm going to use some of the words that I discovered in that record of performance. And I always say, Brent, what else are you going to do with all those OPRs and EPRs in your case other than to use them in this final culminating event for your career? So you need to sit back and relax, because this is going to take me just a little bit of time. So this is the story of Major General Brent Baker. So Brent shared with me that he grew up in Benton, Illinois, a town of just over 7,000 people in the southern part of the state. And while his hometown is small, it is actually the birthplace for several famous people: Olympic and professional basketball player and coach Doug Collins, Academy Award nominee John Malkovich, and I didn't get a chance to ask you this, there's probably a story that goes with this, famous in the Baker family circles, Mr. Mike Hurd, who's here with us today. According to Brent, Mike is known to family members as the man, the myth, the legend, and the reason they bronze baby shoes. See, so there is clearly a story here, but I understood we needed to recognize him accordingly at this ceremony today. Now, Brent was very active during his years at Benton High School. He played basketball, baseball, football, lettered in all three sports. He was a member of the Demole International, which is a Masonic organization dedicated to teaching personal enhancement and instilling leadership in young men. After he graduated from high school in 1978, Brent didn't enter the military right away. He took a little bit of time attending junior college, all the while kind of pondering what his future might be. He came from a blue-collar home. His dad was a conductor and brakeman for the Burlington Northern Railroad, and his mom, who is here today, was a homemaker, but she also worked for Illinois Power when she could. So Brent had that as his background, but he also had military service as his lineage. His dad was an Army veteran. One of his uncles had served in the Navy, and a second uncle was a decorated Marine who had served two tours in Vietnam. And in fact, at one point, Brent himself was very close to joining the Marine Corps. And ironically, it was that uncle who had served in the Marines who talked him out of it. Here's what he said, and I'm quoting, "Brent, you're too smart for the Marines." And urged him to consider the Air Force instead. So we have to thank that uncle. But I have to tell you, even before he started, made his final decision, started on the military path, he met the most important person in his life, his future bride, Robbie. It was in 1978 that Brent was asked to be the best man at his best friend's wedding. The maid of honor across from him was a young lady named Robbie, who also happened to be the sister of the bride. And those folks are here in the audience today. The things I have to say between Brent and Robbie kicked off pretty quickly, but not in probably the most conventional way. It started when the bride and groom asked to borrow Brent's car after the wedding. But Wabbly wanted to make sure that they received proper salutations while they were on the road, and took it upon herself to decorate the car accordingly. So she used black shoe polish to inscribe "Just Married" in big letters on Brent's sparkling white 1967 Chevy Impala. Well, it was really a lovely gesture that came with a pretty significant catch. The shoe polish would not come off. So, shortly after the check from Robbie's dad for a new paint job cleared, the young couple found themselves madly in love. And so I have to tell you, this is Brent's story, and he's sticking to it, Robbie. This was your plan all along. She's nodding her head. She is nodding her head. Well, they dated right up to Brent's Air Force enlistment in January of 1979. He returned the next month from basic training. And just a few weeks later, on February 5th, 1979, the newly minted one-stripe airman and his artistically inclined soulmate. Well, after Brent completed basic training, he was sent to the 47th Flying Training Wing at Wolfenbarger Air Force Base, that's in Texas, to complete his technical school training in fuels. By June of 1979, he emerged as a fully qualified fuel specialist, and as an airman first class, was assigned right there to the 47th Supply Squadron. His EPRs, his enlisted performance reports, lauded him for his careful quality control and operational procedures. That was kind of a common thread, but what I wanted to do right now is share with you some words from his very first EPR, enlisted performance report. These are the words of his boss. "During this reporting period, A1C Baker identified himself as a truly outstanding performer. He increased his technical knowledge at a rapid pace and was soon regarded as a seasoned operator." First EPR. "His unselfish attitude and positive approach toward his duties marked him an effective leader among his peers. He was always eager to assist his fellow airmen." First EPR, can I tell you? I see Major General Brent Baker today in those words. That's the caliber of an airman that he has been for the last 36 years. Well, so all the while he was excelling at his work, he was also busy completing his CDCs, his career development course, and continued to build on those college credits that he had earned before his enlistment. Took classes at a local junior college, and then his supervisors, as he completed that assignment, took note of their driven young airman and pushed him to be promoted ahead of his peers. It didn't take much time for Brent's superior knowledge and work ethic to be put to good use, this time in the 3370th Technical Training Group as a fuels instructor in his home state now, in Illinois. So they moved to Chinook Air Force Base in July of 1980, wasted no time, Brent did, in participating in other additional duties like the Honor Guard, and continuing to impress his leadership with his energy and achievements. Graduated with honors from the Technical Instructor course. And here's some words from his first EPR in this assignment. "Still Airman First Class. Airman First Class Baker has adjusted well to a position normally held by an NCO, a non-commissioned officer with considerable field experience. He was also accruing college credits while off duty, but I stipulate most importantly, it was about a year into this tour that the first of the Baker babies arrived. Their daughter Tiffany was born on July 12, 1981. She came into the world right around the time that her dad pinned on senior airman. Okay, so Tiffany, I hope you don't mind me telling a story. Okay, so this is what your dad shared. He said that you grew up to be something of a master negotiator. It seems that Tiffany wasn't too keen on making her curfew when she went out during high school, and according to her dad, and this is a quote, she would never, and I mean never in capital letters, call when she was running late. But Brent acknowledged that he had a little bit of a soft spot for her diplomacy, and every time she did that, she wrote him a heartfelt apology letter, which he would then let her off the hook because it was such a diplomatic, heartfelt kind of thing. And I have to say, even with that new child in the fold, Brent was selected as the group, and this father was like the group airman of the month for that very same month, July of 1981. And then he led his branch to an overall outstanding rating during a February 1982 inspection, was appropriately named as the Fuels Branch, and ultimately achieved recognition as the Wing Instructor of the Month for that March. He was rewarded for his hard work, selected for promotion, and entered the non-commissioned officer ranks now as a staff sergeant. And if you're counting, if you're keeping track of the calendar continuum here, that's under 4 years that he made the rank of staff sergeant. His supervisor said of Brent, and this is a quote, "Promotion from senior airman to staff sergeant was never more deserved. I am proud to have his acquaintance." So while all that was great recognition in his enlisted career, even better news was on the horizon, because during this assignment, the next little Baker, Amelia, was born on March 18, 1983. When she came along, her dad had just completed his associate's degree in fuels distribution from the Community College of the Air Force and was about to change duty station. So, a little story about Amelia. So, in sharp contrast to her sister, the diplomat, Aaliyah never even tried to get out of her punishments. When she got in trouble, she wouldn't quibble or beg. She just wrote out the sentence. And maybe an even bigger claim to fame for her is that she went on to graduate from college in just 4 years. That's huge these days, but did that attending 5 different schools. That's a lot of ground, even for an Air Force brat, right? Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Well, Brent's next assignment kept him in Illinois. He and his family moved to Scott Air Force Base, where he would return to his roots as a fuel specialist and now became a supervisor, a ship supervisor, this time for the 375th Supply Squadron. And I gotta tell you, the accolades just continue to roll in. Even though he was brand new to this unit, he was selected as the Fuels Person of the Month, his first month on the job. Ultimately, that leading to his recognition as the 1983 Squadron NCO of the Year. Not long after he received that award, he and Robley achieved another milestone in the family. His son, Brent Jr., HB, we call his son, arrived on the 7th of May, 1984. And so, in case y'all didn't notice, HB has sort of followed in his dad's footsteps by joining the military, different service, but pretty awesome that he's decided to do that. And with HB comes the continuation of the family name. We have now H. Brent Baker III, who Brent calls Little Bake. Little Bake, who's here today. Oh, he just pointed at himself. He is here today. Well, with his growing family by his side, Brent continued his quest for self-improvement at the Southern Illinois University Carbondale campus, where he worked towards his bachelor's degree in industrial engineering. By 1985, he had not only completed his bachelor's degree, but he got news that would change the entire trajectory, really, of his Air Force career. He had been accepted to OTS, to Officer Training School. His boss, the chief of the Fuels Management Branch, formally recognized Brent's motivational spirit and this great accomplishment with these words on the performance report: "Staff Sergeant Baker's can-do attitude is an inspiration for his supervisors, peers, and subordinates. His recent selection for Officer Training School was well-deserved and will undoubtedly benefit the Air Force." His squadron commander went further to proclaim that Staff Sergeant Baker was one of their very best. And Brent ended his enlisted career, I found this buried in an EPR, with recognition not only at the numbered Air Force level, 23rd Air Force, but at the MAGCOM level, MAC at the time, Military Airlift Commands, as that command's outstanding senior fuels technician for 1984. Huge recognition as he was ending his enlisted career. And clearly, at this point, it was abundantly clear that Brent was just scratching the surface of his potential. Well, in March of 1985, Brent took the first step in his career as an Air Force officer when he arrived at OTS, held at then Blacklands Air Force Base, Medina Annex, completed OTS, and pinned on second lieutenant in May of the same year, 1985, ready to tackle a new set of challenges as an officer by returning to the Fields community. He was committed to serve in an even higher capacity. He did that, now sporting butter bars, at Andrews Air Force Base. They moved there in May of 1985. He began his first commission assignment as a fuels management officer, responsible for oversight and distribution of that lifeblood for our Air Force fleet. He ensured the safe storage of over 2 million gallons of aviation fuel, serviced over 2,000 aircraft per month. It's an enormous scope of responsibility for a very junior officer, but Brent showcased that same tenacity and superb military bearing that had earned him accolades as an enlisted troop, and his superiors took note. In his first Officer Now performance report, Brent's squadron commander called him, and I quote, "the most professional of my young officers, further saying that Brent set an excellent example for his first term airman. Went on at a next OPR to say he was my best officer, elaborating that he would stack Brent against everyone. And that commander made it even clearer when he said that Brent was head and shoulders above his peers in every respect. He pointed to Brent's professionalism as his strongest attribute, proclaiming that he could not ask for a better example for his NCOs and airmen to emulate. Well, it didn't hurt that Brent also became an honor graduate of two courses, the Air Force Supply Operations Course and the Fuels Management Officers Course. You know, so he'd been working fuels his whole career, and when he made that transition to supply, that was in the October 1986 timeframe, here's what his boss said, and I quote, "Rare is the lieutenant who is proficient in both fuels and supply. Lieutenant Baker is the best in both. The position he occupies calls for an FGO, a field grade officer, yet Second Lieutenant Baker has more than met the challenge." Doing all that is still a second lieutenant. Well, he pinned on first lieutenant in May of 1987. By the time of his first OPR, Officer Performance Report, as a first lieutenant, his name was fresh off the press as the Junior Supply Officer Year Officer of the Year at the numbered Air Force and Major Command levels. By May of 1988, he had completed a master's degree in administration and was already being touted for early promotion. His outgoing commander's parting evaluation letter said this: "Lieutenant Baker has continued to perform in a manner normally observed in only the most senior company grade officers." Really a remarkable statement for someone who had just recently pinned on that silver bar as an O2. Well, Brent departed Andrews Air Force Base in August of 1988, and he took his talents this time outside of our United States. His next assignment was at the Naval Air Station in Keflavik, Iceland. His unit was charged with supplying mission spares and equipment required for 23 air-to-air intercept and detection assets that were assigned to Air Force's Iceland. Under his direction as the chief of the combat operations support, his branch exceeded MAJCOM stalking effectiveness rates by over 20% in two different organizations. His creative thinking and ambition led him to move the entire shop service center under his purview from where it was located previously onto the flight line, and that not only doubled its capacity, but it made thousands of additional parts available to keep aircraft mission capable. His leadership pointed out that Brent had taken a moderately performing organization and transformed it into one of the best in the command. Well, midway through this tour, Brent pinned on the rank of captain. His boss, his squadron commander, said, I like these words, this is a quote, "There's no quit in Brent Baker. Every problem's an opportunity. Leadership is his strong suit. Command position is a must." And his boss's boss, the deputy commander for logistics and support, said, Brent has all of the key leadership attributes, integrity, intelligence, and initiative. Well, during this assignment, Brent got sent to squadron officer school, graduated as a DG. He was also, as he was graduate, he was also the first Air Force's nominee for the Lance P. Cy Joint Leadership Award. He was recognized as the number one company grade supply officer in TAC, the major command, and ultimately in the whole Air Force as the 1990 Outstanding United States Air Force Junior Supply Manager of the Year. Wow. Well, it's clear that as he departed another unit, he had left another lasting impression in his work. Brent returned stateside in August of 1990, was assigned to Langley Air Force Base, served first at TAC, and then TAC transitioned to ACC, Air Combat Command. At TAC, he served as the Supply and Fuels Inspector for Headquarters Tactical Air Command, so he was in the IG organization, and then in ACC, he became the Chief of Supply Policy and Procedures. Well, during his time in the IG as an inspector, he led a study on aircraft mishap rates that was so compelling, the commander of TAC decided that it needed to be briefed at the Tactical Air Forces Commander's Conference. And it should come as no surprise that the IG team chief called Brent, this is a quote, the finest junior officer he had encountered in his Air Force career. Went on to say that Brent's sustained record of achievement was phenomenal. During this assignment, Brent was named as the Headquarters TAC IG Inspector of the Year and went on to win again at the Air Force level. Recognized as the 1991 Howard W. Leaf Inspector General Award winner, which crowned him as the Air Force's IG Inspector of the Year. Wow. Okay, so with all of that high praise and all of those accolades, I got to tell you, I don't think anything could trump this next event in the Baker family history, because it was on May 28, 1991, that baby Julie joined the clan. She tells me she is the best of the kids. She just mentioned that to me. Well, Julie was an exceptional student who graduated high school in just 3 years and then went on to earn her nursing degree from the University of Alabama in Birmingham. Okay? Can I tell this story? I have another claim to fame for you, Julie. She was the only Baker child to make the police blotter when she and some friends decided to do a little off-roading in a future assignment in a desert near Edwards Air Force Base. As it turned out, their adventures were a direct threat to the mild-mannered and highly protected desert tortoise. And the authorities were not impressed enough with their four-wheeling driving skills to let the offense go undocumented. So hence, she's in a police squad. But I think it's too safe to say that she recovered exceptionally well and is doing wonderfully today. Well, Brent next moved over then to headquarters, now ACC, had been headquarters tech. He moved into the LG organization, the logistics organization, and he provided quality procedural guidance to 40 base level units. And I have to say, the things that he did at TAC were so awesome that, in terms of streamlining processes, that they were adopted Air Force-wide. The ACC Chief of Supply Policy and Procedures described Brent as, this is a quote, "the smartest, most productive young supply officer I have seen in over 26 years, a leader, exclamation mark. And his division chief called him, simply the best officer I have ever known, a dynamic person who made a difference. Unlimited potential." Well, when October of 1993 rolled around, Brent had the opportunity to serve on a remote tour for Pacific Air Forces at Kunsan's Air Base in Korea. So it should come as no surprise that he found himself the keeper of, again, another impressive resource portfolio as the Materiel Division Flight Commander. So the flight commander, he was in charge of 26 military personnel, 11 Korean national civilians, and the acquisition of $53.5 million worth of supplies. His team supported 48 F-16 aircraft, over 2,800 personnel. They did so superbly, I have to say, culminating in his squadron receiving the 1993 PACAF Supply Dedalion Award, recognizing them as the best supply squadron in the command. His squadron commander said, "absolutely the best young supply officer that I have seen in my career, my go-to person to get things done." His group commander called Brent my premier company grade officer and insisted that he be selected for command. In October of 1994, Brent found that while his tour in Korea was over, his time in PACAF was not. He was now headed to the PACAF headquarters to serve as the Chief of Supply Procedures and Analysis. He spearheaded an implementation of an updated computer system that reduced depot response time by 90%. His division chief handpicked him to establish a field logistics field operating agency to work critical base issues. And as the dust settled and that project was declared a success, that chief called Brent, and I quote, "a sterling performer who had been selected early for command." So it was in July of 1995 that he had his chance to serve in that command role for the first time. Went off to Eielson Air Force Base in Alaska as a junior major, and that is, and promoted below the zone ahead of his peers to the rank of major. He was now in formal command of a squadron, one that was managed a supply account that was valued at $262 million. Wow, he was given credit for putting in place a mobility equipment sourcing initiative that saved $181,000. In his 1996 performance report, his wing commander made it crystal clear that Brent had excelled in his command duties, calling him, and I quote, "without question, the finest supply squadron officer I have ever known. A superstar with unlimited potential." And Brent's efforts culminated in more recognition. He was recognized as the 1997 PACAF Senior Supply Manager of the Year. So his tenure in his first command assignment culminated with a return to Maxwell Air Force Base when he was selected for an in-residence slot at Air Command and Staff College. He did extraordinarily well there, top 20% of his class, authored two number one rated exam essays in the course of his work. Just before he pinned on his next rank, Lieutenant Colonel, again below the zone, he took on a new job there, right there, at Maxwell Air Force Base. He served as the Air Force Seamless Supply Manager. So he's now working for the first time in Air Force Material Command for the Headquarters Standard Systems Group. He was charged with leading a team with crafting the overarching regulation for the management of our $45 billion standard-based supply system that's utilized by, back then, 20,000 supply troops worldwide. And his stellar leadership resulted in the zero findings for his unit during a headquarters AFMC unit compliance inspection, and again, as he has throughout his career, the opportunity to identify where there could be savings to be garnered. He identified initiatives that saved this time $350,000 in savings. His division chief called Brent a superior logistician, unlike any I have ever seen, with an incredible gift for bringing solutions to the table. Well, Brent's next move came in 1999. He was sent to work to the Pentagon in Washington, D.C., worked on the joint staff. He was responsible to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, working as a maintenance and supply joint logistics planner. He had the opportunity to help shape maintenance, supply, and readiness policies really across all the services. During that time, he conducted an in-depth analysis on a Kosovo after-action report and uncovered shortfalls in the Air Force's fighter aircraft support kits. And as a result of that, he took on the initiative to drive a $78 million action to correct that issue. He also won congressional support for $1 billion in increased funding for spares and maintenance backlog. When it was all said and done, Brent was selected to again attend school of residence, this time the Air War College. He was rated as the best action officer in his directorate by the J4 director, and he was recognized as the 2001 J4 Action Officer of the Year. At Air War College, Brent dedicated himself to earning a master's degree in strategic studies, and again, he showcased his academic prowess when he co-authored a research paper on the topic of diversity that would be ranked as the top paper produced all year by his seminar. Moved on next to from Air War College to work again in AFMC. This time he worked in Georgia, Warner Robins Air Force Base and Air Logistics Center at that time, Robins Air Force Base. He served as the Communications Support Division Chief there. Again, another sizable undertaking. He was in charge of 186 avionics systems, 9,000 other assets. I have to tell you, he showcased some natural talents, which I hope you've been picking up as I've been talking here. Not only in terms of forward thinking and innovation, but also in that budgetary lane. He secured $13 billion in additional funds for essential spare components. And as Operation Iraqi Freedom created an escalating strain on the supply chain, he responded by forming an integrated product team that met surge demand in the order of thousands. 5,328 drove an unbelievable 99.2% fill rate for those requested parts. His director of avionics management said this about Brent: a powerful leader, reputation is known throughout the Air Force and the Department of Defense, a model of all Air Force core values, destined for greatness, a fabulous officer, on his way to group command with the highest endorsement. And that's what he did next. Moved on to his opportunity to command at the group level. Did that in July of 2003, as he became now a full group colonel, and again, promoted below the zone ahead of his peers. Returned to PACAF, which is a major command that he loves, and served as the 18th Mission Support Group Commander at Kadena Air Base in Japan, largest mission support group in the Air Force. He was directly in charge of 4,000 people across six squadrons, supported an installation of $6 billion in assets. One of his primary focus areas during his tenure was quality of life. He procured $250 million in funds to upgrade numerous morale assets and facilities, assuring the highest quality of life for his troops. And his actions got the attention they deserved. The 18th Wing Commander gave Brent a strong push to command an air base wing of his own. He said this: number one pick for toughest air base wing CC job right now, which is what he got a chance to do. In June of 2005, he had a little bit of a stepping stone approach to becoming an air base wing commander. He served first as the vice commander of the 95th Air Base Wing, which is a primary infrastructure provider for our Air Force flight test center at Edwards Air Force Base, back into AFMC. So he helped to manage three groups, a directorate, seven staff agencies for the command's test and evaluation mission. That included 14,000 people and 100 aircraft. And as Brent, as the vice, he had the opportunity to help build a battle staff team that provided timely support to the higher headquarters in the aftermath of two big events at that time, Hurricanes Katrina and Rita, and also the opportunity to coordinate a return flight for the Space Shuttle Discovery. The Flight Test Center commander ranked Brent as his number one of three vice commanders and his number one choice for Air Base Wing Commander, which is exactly what he did in June of 2008, Brent filled those shoes. He's now the commander of the Air Base Wing, and his tenure saw the best in command performance in a whole bunch of different capacities. He drove down environmental inspection findings to the lowest they had ever been in the history of the MAGCOM inspection program, from 48 down to 25. He raised $21 million to upgrade what was characterized as an ancient information technology system on base, which mitigated really a 50-year system vulnerability. And the center commander said, these words about Brent, awesome, visionary, achieved 2006 AFMC bests in five different categories, A to Z focus on airmen. And Sharkey had left yet another positive impression on the people that he supported and the leadership that he served. In 2007, Brent was ready to take over an interesting series of assignments. He started out serving as the commander of the Provisional Air Force Global Logistics Support Center right here at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. The GLSC wasn't really intended to be, and was an Air Force level center that provided worldwide logistics as the Air Force supply chain manager. Not only did he stand up this huge new organization, he did it on time and on budget. With the center fully activated at Scott Air Force Base, he then transitioned to serve as its first vice commander, and then shortly after that, as the commander. Some words from our Air Force Material Command vice at the time, one of Brent's predecessors, that was Terry Gresky, in the seat at the time. This is what she said about Brent: visionary leader, agent for Air Force transformation, huge intellect, world-class leader who gets outstanding results. To tell you, this tough gauntlet really challenges. It was our first ever initiative to bring together a whole host of disparate, decentralized activities in the supply chain world into this one center. I have to tell you, it was a proving ground and a perfect segue for him to rise as a general officer into those ranks. He did that in July of 2009, became a brigadier general, and now was assigned as the director of logistics for PACAF, back into that major command that he had spent quite a bit of his time in at Hickam Air Force Base in Hawaii. He impressed his leadership in this first general officer assignment, as you all would expect. The PACAF commander he served to, the first remark about Brent, hit the ground running in PACAF as our newest general officer. He performs like a seasoned veteran. The second PACAF commander he served said this about Brent: driving force in PACAF and PACOM, relentless pursuit of maintenance and logistics excellence. Brent Baker is an absolute 10, and he is absolutely ready for two-star now. The words of two very clearly impressed supervisors. You know, I think if you look at his career history, as I've already mentioned, Brent spent a great deal of time overseas during his career in that PACAF arena. And these tours gave him really some unique opportunities. Before leaving Hickam this time, he experienced what he considers to be the proudest moment of his career, Operation Tamagotchi, in the shadow of Japan's 2011 earthquake and then the subsequent tsunami that it generated, and much of the country was in a severe state of ruin, which was further exacerbated, if you think back to your history, by the Fukushima nuclear meltdown. So along with our sister services, Brent and his team really stepped up to provide critical relief to those disasters' refugees. When Brent and his family departed their final PACAF assignment in July of 2011, they returned to Scott Air Force Base one last time. Brent was now working for AFMC again, commanding again the Air Force's Global Logistics Support Center. We put him in charge of this Department of Defense most diverse supply chain, managing 4,600 people across seven different operating locations and entrusting him with $35 billion in assets. And what has become really a hallmark. Really, I think you agree, be a hallmark of his distinguished service. He didn't just meet the challenge, he ran right through it. He led his center to the NDIA's 2011 Supply Chain Operational Excellence Award and the 2011 Air Force Garrity Award, recognizing them as the top supply organization in the Air Force. And our service acknowledged Brent's superior performance and potential to serve in the higher grade by promoting him to Major General on November 2012. And I tell you what, I couldn't be prouder. We had done such an admirable job. He considers Brent as his service as the Global Logistics Support Center's first and last commander to be one of the great distinctions in his career, cementing in history when we stood it down in the 2012 AFOC restructure. Well, knowing what a brilliant star we had in our hands, we didn't hesitate to increase Brent's mission scope when we sent him to Hill Air Force Base in Utah to command as the first ever Ogden Air Logistics Complex commander. And here was when he would reach an incredible milestone, earning his seventh command assignment. Wow, that's extraordinary. He's been a commander 7 times. So his challenge at Ogden at Hill Air Force Base was fleet readiness. An enormous fleet of cutting-edge aircraft relied on his ability to deliver timely depot maintenance. To accomplish that, he implemented the AFSC way, the Air Force Sustainment Center way at Ogden, which he regards as one of the capstone achievements of his time there at Hill. So over 2 years, that discipline process improvement methodology that he implemented resulted in 98% on-time delivery for 1,400 aircraft, saved $198 million taxpayer dollars. Not only that, but he provided extraordinary support that ensured our critical nuclear priorities were met, ensuring that our nation's strategic deterrence capabilities remained robust. I said this about Brent during this assignment, and I want to get to some quotes from me. A brilliant leader who inspires his team to achieve art of the possible results. Brent uses his accomplishments at Hill to be some of the greatest in his 36 years of service. Well, after his spectacular tenure at the Air Logistics Complex, it was time to bring Brent right back here to the headquarters. It was in September of 2014 that we brought him back to serve for a brief stint as our Director of Logistics, and then ultimately I asked him to serve as my Vice Commander. A final assignment that he says, I have it in writing, that he's truly enjoyed. I say that I couldn't have had a better vice, and I should know, since I served as the AFMC Vice Commander in the past. And I have to tell you, Brent has absolutely excelled. He can multitask like nobody I know. He can juggle a whole bunch of balls all at the same time, knocking down barriers, achieving huge advances, taking care of the mission, all the while taking care of the people too. And you'll hear more about those accomplishments in a few minutes when we present Brent with another award. As this final chapter in Brent's career comes to an end, he and Robin Lee will retire. They've already got that house set up and they're ready to move in to Nashville, Tennessee. And they will continue celebrating their love of church, family, and each other in a different location in Nashville. And in preparation for the ceremony, I asked Brent about some of the goals he had when he first came into the Air Force and ones that he would like to achieve in the future. He said that when he started his career, his goals were to simply make the rank of major and serve for 30 years. And we all know how that turned out. Mission accomplished and then some for his military goals. And then he said that down the road, he'd love to get into politics, perhaps serve as a state governor. And I have to say, I really wish you all the best in that pursuit. And I can think of no more honorable individual to take on those roles for our country. It has been my absolute privilege to be here today to revisit just a few of the incredible accomplishments of Major General Brent Baker. These accomplishments have been made really to support our Air Force and to support our nation over the last 3.5+ decades. His service to our Air Force has been exceptional in every way. You know, it's hard to keep count. I tried to keep track of it for you. I know I didn't cover them all, of all the awards he's received, and we're getting ready to present another one, as I mentioned, in just a few minutes. But most importantly, Brent has been a great mentor, leader, and airman. Throughout his career, he demonstrated extraordinary commitment and dedication that will live on as his enduring legacy. He has absolutely made a lasting impact on our Air Force. And I know that you will all agree with me that the use of the word honor is so absolutely fitting this morning. So, Brent, I wanted to extend my personal thanks to you and Natalie and the rest of your family for serving our nation, because it is a team sport when you decide to put a career in service to our Air Force or to our nation. You will absolutely be missed in the halls of AFMC, but I have to stipulate across our Air Force as well. Now, as you look forward to the future and the next phase of your life, I wanted to just come back to that word again, honor. We honor you for your great contributions, and we wish you and your family the absolute best in all of our future adventures. Thank you all very much. Let's get on with our ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the presentation of the Distinguished Service Medal. The President of the United States of America, authorized by Act of Congress, July 9, 1918, awards the Distinguished Service Medal to Major General H. Brent Baker, Sr., for exceptional and meritorious service in duties of responsibility. General Baker distinguished himself first as Director of Logistics and then as Vice Commander, Air Force Materiel Command, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio, from 25 September 2014 to 30 November 2015. As Director of Logistics, General Baker led the largest and most complex directorate in the headquarters. His vision enhanced the sustainment technology process, which integrates the centers and programs with a standard process to identify, prioritize, fund, and install accountability in $100 million in technology investment, improving aircraft availability, and reducing sustainment costs. Furthermore, he provided critical strategic direction leading the deficiency identification in the long-duration logistics war game initiative. As Vice Commander, General Baker's pioneering efforts were instrumental in the stand-up of the Air Force Installation and Mission Support Center, the single intermediate-level organization for providing installation and mission support capabilities to 10 major commands, 2 direct reporting units, and 77 installations. Additionally, he fulfilled the Secretary of the Air Force's vision for the Air Force Nuclear Weapons Center reorganization effort, resulting in the transition of 1,900 personnel and more than $150 million of assets across 3 major commands. Through General Baker's efforts, the Air Force is postured to provide more efficient lifecycle sustainment and will resolve seams and conflicts in maintaining effective mission readiness across the nuclear enterprise. Finally, he chaired the command's Community Action Intermediate Information Board, solely responsible for increasing the focus and fostering and maintaining a culture of respect and resiliency throughout the command. The singularly distinctive accomplishments of General Baker culminate a long and distinguished career in the service of his country and reflect the highest credit upon himself and the United States Air Force. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the reading of the retirement order.
Publish the order.
Attention order. Special order number 000082, 23 April 2015. Major General Howard Brent Baker, Sr. is relieved as Vice Commander, Air Force Materiel Command, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio, and is retired effective 30 November 2015 per AFI 363203 in the grade of Major General by order of the Secretary of the Air Force. General Wolfenbarger will now present the retirement certificate to Major General Baker. The certificate reads as follows. Certificate of retirement from the Armed Forces of the United States of America. To all who shall see these, presents greeting. This is to certify that Major General Howard B. Baker, having served faithfully and honorably, was retired from the United States Air Force on the first day of December 2015. Signed, General Mark A. Welsh III, Chief of Staff. General Wolfenbarger will now present Major General Baker with a certificate of appreciation from our Commander-in-Chief. The certificate reads as follows. Major General Howard B. Baker, Sr., I extend to you my personal thanks and the sincere appreciation of a grateful nation for your contribution of honorable service to our country. You have helped maintain the security of the nation during a critical time in its history with a devotion to duty and a spirit of sacrifice in keeping with the proud traditions of military service. Your commitment and dedication have been an inspiration for those who will follow in your footsteps and for all Americans who join me today in saluting you for a job extremely well done. My best wishes to you for happiness and success in the future. Barack Obama, Commander-in-Chief. From the Secretary of the Air Force. The letter reads as follows. Dear General Baker, please accept my sincere appreciation for your 36 years of devoted service to our Air Force and the nation. The sacrifices you and your family have made in pursuit of this demanding profession are a tribute to your character and patriotism. Looking back on your extraordinary career, we are forever grateful for the dedication and leadership you demonstrated, defending our great country and promoting democracy and freedom throughout the world. As you move on to new challenges, from your early years as a fields instructor to your position as a Vice Commander, Headquarters Air Force Materiel Team, you can reflect with great pride and satisfaction on your distinguished military career and your vast contributions to the United States Air Force. I wish you the very best in the years ahead. Sincerely, Deborah Lee James, Secretary of the Air Force. General Wolfenbarger will now present Major General Baker with a letter of appreciation from the Chief of Staff of the Air Force. The letter reads as follows. Dear General Baker, on the occasion of your retirement, please accept my personal thanks for your loyal and dedicated service to the United States Air Force and our country. Throughout your remarkable 36-year career, your commitment to excellence has remained constant as you progressed to positions of increased trust and responsibility. From the early years as a fields instructor to major and joint commands, you've ensured our forces are well prepared for the challenges of the 21st century. As Vice Commander, Headquarters Air Force Materiel Command, your leadership and vision have been key for employing 80,000 people, managing $60 billion annually in research and development, while providing the acquisitions, management, services, and logistics support required to develop, procure, and sustain Air Force weapon systems. You can be justifiably proud of your achievements and service to our nation. Betty joins me in wishing you and Robert Lee the very best in the coming years. Sincerely, Mark A. Walsh, Chief of Staff. At this time, will Mrs. Baker please come forward? Mrs. Baker will now present her husband with the Air Force Retirement Pin. The Air Force Retirement Pin symbolizes retiring from active duty and beginning the next chapter in his life. General Wolfenbarger will now present Mrs. Baker with the Air Force Certificate of Appreciation. The certificate reads as follows. Certificate of Appreciation from the United States Air Force. In grateful appreciation, the United States Air Force presents this certificate of recognition to Robert Lee Baker for the commitment and numerous contributions that made positive impacts to the nation's defense. Thank you for the support which gave strength and purpose to your spouse's service. Signed, General Mark A. Welch III, Chief of Staff. At this time, General Wolfenbarger would like to make a personal presentation to General Mrs. Baker.
This has become a personal tradition of mine. Every time I'm asked to officiate at a retirement, I'm excited to do this the first time, which was probably when I was a lieutenant colonel. I've been doing this for a long, long time now. I have come to present the same gift every time because I found one that's just perfect, I believe. It is a Waterford crystal ball. I pick Waterford because I believe it's the highest caliber crystal that's available on the market, and my hope is that in presenting this gift that Brent and Robert Lee will use it, number one, and two, think of it as a tribute to the caliber of their service, their collective service to our Air Force and our nation. I'd like to present this on behalf of Wolf and myself, but as I think about Brent's extraordinary career, and I know the support that Robert Lee provided not only to him, but to the families and the airmen as well, I'd like to present this gift on behalf of all of those individuals that Brent and Robert Lee have touched over the last 36 plus years. And let me just one last thing. This bowl actually has a name. It's on the outside of the box. It's called the Honor Bowl. I thought it was absolutely perfect. Thank you very much.
Thank you, General Wolfenbarger and Mrs. Baker. General Ellen Polakowski, Commander, Air Force Materiel Command, will now come forward and make remarks, and with the assistance of Colonel Keith Bearden, will present a chat at the table to Major General Baker on behalf of the men and women of Headquarters Air Force Materiel.
Well, I haven't had an opportunity to work with General Baker for very long, but I can tell you I sure am glad that Marine recommended that he join the junior service. And, you know, that's what the other services call us, the junior service, since we weren't around when the rest of them were stood up. But it's kind of good to be the junior service. One of the things when you're in the junior service is you get to steal all the good ideas and traditions from those senior services. And one of those is the shadow box. The shadow box actually comes from the Navy. And our U.S. Navy is very, very strong on tradition, but also on superstition. And the shadow box dates back from when a sailor would finish his last tour and he would walk off of the ship. If his shadow touched the ground before he did, then it was bad luck, right? So what the U.S. Navy did, standing for unique and self-sufficient, they decided that they would give the sailor a box. And in the box, we put those unique things that represented that sailor. And so then when the sailor walked off the ship, as long as he didn't put the box on the ground before he stepped on the ground himself, he would have good luck. Well, Brent, I'm looking at this, and I'm glad you brought a lot of family with you. Otherwise, you're in for many years of bad luck. But the box that the sailor would have was obviously a lot smaller and not quite as exquisite as this. But Brent, I don't know how we could fit all of the things that you represent from the 36 years you've done in anything more than less than this. And this represents those 36 years, the shadow box does, but I think what's also really special about this is that this was made with the hands of the airmen that served with you. And it is really my distinct honor as the current sitting commander of Air Force Materiel Command to represent the men and women of the headquarters in presenting the shadow box to you. And one of the craftsmen, Colonel Bearden, is here to help me to do that.
Detail. Post. As members of the United States military, military customs are an important part of our daily lives. These customs, stemmed from tradition and passed down to us from people like Major General Baker, teach us about respect to our flag. They remind us of the allegiance and sacrifices required of all military personnel. What you are about to witness is a part of these ceremonies which allows us to properly honor those who have served well and faithfully. This ceremony represents all ranks held by Major General Baker during his career in the United States Air Force. The passing of our nation's flag signifies General Baker's progression through the Air Force grade structure. My last parade. Let the bugle blow, let the march be played, with a forming of the airmen for my last parade. Airman First Class Baker is an airman any supervisor would love to have working for him. His professionalism is comparable to individuals of much greater rank. He sets an outstanding example for his contemporaries and deserves to be promoted now. The years of wars and the years of waiting, obedience to orders, unhesitating. Staff Sergeant Baker has done it all and done it to perfection. He was cited in the latest Supply Staff Assistance Visit Report for his laudatory management of our Fuel Control Center. Years in the States and years overseas, all woven in a web of memories. Lieutenant Baker is second to none. I will stack him against any other fuels management officer in the Air Force. He is an honor graduate of the U.S. Air Force Supply Operations Course and the Fuels Management Officer Course. A lifetime of service passes in review, as many good friends and exotic places, too. Captain Baker is the number one company-grade officer in Tactical Air Command. Mark him to be a supply squadron commander soon. In the waning sunlight begin to fade with the martial music of my last parade. Major Baker is my number one of 16 squadron commanders, best supply commander I've seen, utterly superb leader, officer, on his way to greatness in the Air Force, always leads from the front on every initiative, every task or challenge. My last salute to the service and base. Now someone else will take my place. Lieutenant Colonel Baker was awarded the 2000 Joint Staff J4 Action Officer of the Year. Nation's Action Officer briefed SecDef on aviation readiness. Make him a logistics commander next. To the sharp young airmen marching away, I'll gladly pass the orders of the day. Colonel Baker is my number one draft pick for the biggest mission support group in the Air Force, MVP, leading group to countless wins. Kadena's mayor sustains delicate union with local community leader, thwarts political tensions, large airbase wing commander next. Though uncertain of what my future may hold, still, if needed, before I grow too old. Brigadier General Baker is the finest director of logistics I've ever seen. Must promote now, huge future. ALC Commander, Joint Chief of Staff J4 to half A4, unlimited potential. I'll keep my saber sharp, my powder dry, lest I be recalled to duty by and by. Major General Baker is a brilliant leader who inspires his team to achieve art of the possible results. He's led Ogden Air Logistics Center to unmatched performance and capability improvements while reducing costs. His ability to predict challenges, discern solutions, and build teams to achieve cost-effective readiness is setting the AFSC pace. Detail, host. So let the bugle blow, fire the evening gun, slowly lower the colors. My retirement has begun. United States Air Force retirement.
Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing? I just want to say, first of all, thanks so much for coming out. This has been an amazing ceremony. General Wolfenbarger, General Polakowski, everyone, thanks for coming out. I will tell you, if you know me, and obviously most of you do, I usually just speak from the cuff, but I am not going to attempt to do that today. Okay, I'm going to read. I want to make sure I hit some very important things, so this is unusual for me, but I'm going to read my comments, and I have to wear my glasses. First of all, I want to thank everyone for coming out today. Wow, what a day. Nearly 37 years ago, I remember it like it was yesterday. Bob Lee, my dad and I left our home at 4 a.m. headed towards St. Louis, Missouri, as I had to report into the MEPS station to start my Air Force career. I will also never forget, it was foggy that morning, really more foggy than any other time that I can remember. We had to follow a semi-tractor trailer to actually make it, but we did. That morning was very representative of my career. No, not the fog, but rather wonderful support from my family and my best friend, Robert Lee, by my side, always by my side. Where did the time go? I believe on a day like today, it's important to say thanks. First, I want to say thanks to my Heavenly Father, who gave me the strength and the health to accomplish all I have done. I think of all the moves, all the TDYs, the travels, movements, hours, just the travel verses alone are amazing. Rob Lee and I have a verse that we claim throughout our marriage and Air Force career. It's Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. God always honors his promises. I also want to say thanks to General Wolfenbarger for taking time to come out of retirement and officiate this ceremony. As many of you know, General Wolfenbarger was the first four-star female general officer of our Air Force, and we have been friends and co-workers for some time. So, ma'am, I want to thank you for this very special day. Having done a few of these retirements myself, I know how much work goes into preparing for the event. General Polakowski, ma'am, thanks for being here today, and I really enjoyed our time together. I also want to thank all the people involved in making this day so special. From the Air Force Museum staff, who always do such a nice job, to the Honor Guard, to the A4 Longy team for pulling all this together, to the Air Force Band, to Protocol, to Major Rose Engelbert, my executive officer, who's done an amazing job over the last couple of months getting me ready to retire. She really did all the work, quite frankly. And I want to thank Pastor Howe for being here today, and thank you for your prayer. I also want to say thanks to all my friends that are here today. We have made amazing lifelong friends along the way. Thank you so much for being here and making the choice, spending the money, taking the time to share this day with the Bakers. If we had the time, I would like to mention every single one of you by name because you mean so much to Rob Lee and me. Over the next day, you will get a chance to say a special thanks to each and every one of you. I also want to say a special thanks to the team that made the Shadow Box. They affectionately call themselves Team Sawdust. Bruce Smith, Colonel Keith Bearden, and Ken Willing. And you'll get a chance to see it. I will tell you, these things are a work of art, and more importantly, that it's a work of love. I don't know how many hours they spend on those, but if you've ever done any woodworking, it's very impressive, so thank you. Next, I want to say thanks to my and Rob Lee's families. As you can see, we have a very large and supportive family that have been a huge part of our 37-year journey. I was very fortunate to marry into a loving, godly family. My best friend from high school, Mike Kerr, is here, and he's also my brother-in-law, as I introduced him to his wife, Rob Lee's sister, Becky. Hey, Mike, you're welcome. I had the honor, a great honor, of retiring Mike from the Air Force just a few years ago as a master sergeant. Mike has a pet name for all the brown girls, and only Mike could get away with this. He has a pet name for them. He calls them the brown cows. Their maiden name is brown. Well, I sure love all the brown cows. Doris, I also want to say a special thanks to you. You are the best mother-in-law in the world. You are an amazing woman, and the girls are just a mere shadow of you. This lady will get up at 4 a.m., make homemade ice cream, fix a huge meal of chicken and dumplings, watch kids, teach Sunday school class, play the piano at church, lead the choir, and that's just before noon on Sunday. You have always been there if we ever needed you. You and Vernon were absolutely the best. Thank you so much. And my mom, Mommy Baker, thank you so much for being here today. There is no doubt that you and Dad made me what I am today. I had an amazing childhood with nothing but wonderful memories of my youth. You and Dad encouraged all three of us kids to love God, be good people, and to work hard for what we want to achieve. You are the best mother a boy could ever have. I wish Dad was here today, as he would be so proud. I also wish my sister was here to celebrate with us today. You are a strong, loving mother, and I thank you for all the sacrifices that you made through the years, and I'm proud of how well you've done handling some very tough situations over the past few years. I love you. Now I want to say just a few things about my children. First, though, let me just say that I have the best, and I mean the very best, daughter and son. They are not all Alabama or Dallas Cowboy fans, so they have a couple of minor issues, but they are amazing people and parents. Tiffany, my oldest daughter, you are an incredible person and you are a mirror image of your dad. I will never forget when you were young, how you would always meet me at the door and you would say, "Dad, I have my homework done, I practice my piano, I practice basketball, I practice my trumpet all day." You are a go-getter. I love you, and thanks for giving us MJ, my super little athlete, and Faith. Faith, you're the smartest three-year-old I know. Aaliyah, you have Dad's tender heart, and you are so fun. Your sense of humor is superb. I will never forget when you were about 10, I calling you HB, Mutt and Jeff, as you two were walking up the sidewalk after school, and you quickly replied without beating a beat to my dad and I, "Look, HB, it's Beavis and Butthead." I love you. Thanks for Ethan. We call him Little Shugs because he's so sweet, and Bella, our little blue-eyed enforcer. HB, I am so proud to call you my son. I only have one son, but I cannot imagine a better boy and young man. He never cost me a dime. He didn't even have to have braces. We share the same passions for Alabama football, Roll Tide Roll, and America's team, the Dallas Cowboys. We also share the love of basketball, the greatest game ever. I was so happy I got to coach your high school team, and you were the best point guard ever. I love you, and thanks for Brent, or as we call him, Little Bake, our little genius boy, and Marky, the naked guitar player. If you want to see the video, Grandma's got it. It's worth seeing. Jules, you were our little surprise child, and not only did we get a surprise, but we got a precious gift. I cannot imagine our family without your warm smile and infectious laugh. If you're not having fun around Julie, then you must be dead, as Julie is the most fun person I know. You are Mom's kindred spirit, but you are my baby always. I love you, and thanks for Lillian, or Seven, as I like to call her for all you Seinfeld fans, and the future James Marshall, or Jimmer, as I will call him, unless you switch from Auburn football to Alabama, then I will call him by his proper name. Now for my bride in nearly 37 years. Rob Lee doesn't like it when I brag or say much about him, but today will have to be an exception. This is your day as well. Rob Lee, thanks for being the best wife and friend ever. My best day? The day I met you. You have always been the smartest, most emotionally stable, selfless, mature person I have ever met. Thanks for 37 years as a wonderful military spouse, you serve too. Many nice things have been said about me today, but the real talent, and anybody that knows us knows this, the real talent in the Baker family is Robin. She's pretty, she can sew, she can cook, she can make quilts, she can play the piano, she can play the piano by ear. She can play music by ear. She can even do puppets. She's an amazing puppeteer. At her high school graduation, she should have just stayed on the stage as she won every award presented. She gave up her aspirations to attend Asbury University to become Aaron's wife and to raise her family. We have a saying in our family, and it's true. Everybody loves Rob Lee. I'd say you've done an amazing job. Okay. My words of wisdom as I leave the Air Force. Enjoy every day and cherish the friendships you will and are making, because in the end, that's what counts and what you will remember. Confucius said that a wise man looks forward to the end of the journey as well as to the beginning. Today, we have both. Thank you very much.
Appreciation for his contribution to the Air Force and its mission, the men and women of the United States Air Force are proud to have served with General Baker and assure him he will always be a valuable member of the Air Force family, even in retirement. We wish the Baker family every success in their future endeavors. We invite everyone to join General Wolfenbarger in congratulating the Bakers in a receiving line in the back of the room and join the family for refreshments. Please join us at this time for the playing of the Air Force song and the departure of the official party. This concludes today's ceremony. Thank you for attending, and we wish you a pleasant afternoon.